I would like to read with you, please, this evening in Ephesians chapter 4. Lovely to have so many coming along, and we appreciate the adjustment to your schedule in order to be here for these studies. Ephesians chapter 4, and we'll read from verse 1. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation with which you are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, even as you are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That's all the reading we'll do for the sake of time, but I would encourage you to read the rest of the section as you study the notes a little later. And we're going to be thinking about the body, part one. We'll be looking at the subject for two evenings. And this evening we'll be thinking about the unity and the diversity of the church, especially as we have it here in Ephesians chapter 4. In our first lesson, we thought about the various ways that God communicates truth regarding the church, and the one we looked at that evening were the 10 metaphors, word pictures, that are used of the church. And one of those, one of the most dominant and most expressive, is the body, with the church as the body of Christ and he himself as the head. Now, that in itself ought to shock us, that the Lord would so identify with us, he would think of himself in such intimate connection with his people that he would consider himself to be the head of the body. Now, the queen is a head of sort. She is a figurehead. She doesn't really control the parliament or the passing of laws. She has a particular symbolic role in the government. But you don't have a figurehead of a body. You have a functioning head. And it has been unfortunate that in the history of the church, there has been an increasing move towards marginalizing the role of Christ actively in the life of the church. And so we have other headquarters, other chains of command, other people who make the decisions for the church, where in reality, the purpose of the Godhead was that the Lord Jesus himself would be a functioning head of the body. Now, there is a disease they used to call St. Vitus Dance, where the body didn't pay any attention to the head. And there were constant and various jerks of the body because the head was not in control. And we can certainly see a great deal of jerking that goes on in the church because we're not paying attention to the head. This subject is of vital interest to those who want to understand how it is that the Lord Jesus communicates with us. There are some people who have the strange idea that the Lord Jesus has a communications problem, and he can't quite get his point across, and they say things like, well, what does he do, send a postcard? Well, I have never found the Lord Jesus to have a problem getting his point across to me. It seems to me that the problem is at our end, at the listening end, not at his end of communication. When we think about this subject of the unity of the body and its diversity, this little section in Ephesians chapter 4 stands out as unique. Now, we have four great passages in the New Testament that deal with the subject of gifts and their exercise: Romans 12, 1 Corinthians 12, Ephesians 4, and 1 Peter 4. They all have a little different emphasis, but Ephesians chapter 4 is quite distinct from the other three. And I've given you a little chart in your notes here showing that in Romans 12 and 1 Corinthians 12, the giver is the Spirit. There are different gifts, but the same Spirit, says Paul to the Corinthians. But in Ephesians chapter 4, we notice that the giver is the resurrected and soon to be exalted Christ. When he rose from the dead, he gave the spoils of war, which he had won at Calvary, to the enrichment of the church. And then he went back to heaven. These particular gifts are different, in a sense, from the gifts that are described in Romans 12 and 1 Corinthians 12, in that in the other passages, they are supernatural abilities. So, for example, we will read about the gift of giving or the gift of teaching. But here you'll notice in Ephesians chapter 4 that it is the gift of the teacher. In other words, they're not abilities that are given by the Spirit as we have them in the other passages. They are actually gifted men who are given by Christ to the church. The third distinction is most important, that in Romans and 1 Corinthians, the gifts are given for the health of the local assembly, the local church. Whereas the book of Ephesians has a much wider sweep. It is focusing on the universal church. And these particular men have gifts that are wider than any particular local church. For example, the apostles and prophets. You didn't have your own local prophet who gave local prophecies for your local benefit. The apostles and prophets, as we see in chapter 2 of Ephesians, were foundational to the whole church. And so these particular men, although we have local teachers and local evangelists and local shepherds that function in the context of local churches, these men were given for the expansion of the church beyond those local gatherings that presently exist. These men, they broke out into new areas, into regions where Christ's name has not been heard, and they saw the establishment of new assemblies of God's people. And so the work spread across the world. So there are those whose responsibility it is for the maintenance of existing churches. But these men were responsible for breaking out of the territory that had already been covered and reaching into new areas. Now we're, I think, all committed to the idea that God wants individual believers to reproduce themselves, to have spiritual children. But God is also interested in churches reproducing themselves, in seeing new gatherings of believers started, not simply maintaining what is there. Now, that's important, and God has, through the Spirit, gifted individual believers in each local church for the well-being of that local church. But then there is this other aspect, not so much the consolidation of the work of God, but the expansion of the work of God. And that's, I think, what we have here in Ephesians chapter 4. The emphasis is on the growing of the church, isn't it? Not simply maintaining the health of the existing gatherings of believers, but the growing of it, the growing up of it. And so we have this clear distinction in Ephesians chapter 4. I want to think a little bit with you now about the head-body relationship and the member-to-member relationship. There are three sections here, and the first being the relationship between the body and the head. Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, we'll be looking at that passage on another evening. In 1 Corinthians 11, 3, the Lord is referred to there as the head relative to government. The church government. It's not really the body, the functioning of the body that's involved there. It's headship relative to church government, the head of the woman is the man, the head of the man is Christ, the head of Christ is God. And we have a whole lesson on that particular subject of men-women roles in the church. Then Peter also speaks about Christ as the head, but he's thinking about him as the headstone of the corner. The Lord Jesus is the first stone laid in the foundation. He's the Alpha. He's the beginner. He's the author. But he's also the capstone, the keystone, the finishing touch, the grand finale to the church. He is also the finisher. He is the not only the one who is the initiator of the plan, but he's the one who, having said, "I will build my church," is going to be the finishing touch. And the prophecy of Zechariah describes that day when God brings out the headstone. To the cries of the people, not glory, glory, but grace, grace unto it. And God will bring out the headstone, the stone which the builders rejected, which has become the headstone of the corner. And what a glorious day it will be when God at last will be vindicated, and the one who is despised and rejected of men will take the highest seat in glory. He's been sitting on his Father's throne all these years, waiting until his enemies are made his footstool. And when the last enemy is put down, a real man will ascend the steps to the throne of God and will sit down on his own throne, and every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. What a day, glorious day that will be. There are six passages here that I have recorded for you, and you're going to have to study these out on your own. But they're worth a week's Bible study all on their own. Three references in Ephesians and three references in Colossians that specifically have to do now with the head of the body. And each has its own particular encouragement, its particular truth. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 22, for example, we have the headship of Christ linked to his putting everything under his feet. Hebrews chapter 2, 1 Corinthians 15, they speak about this, how Adam put everything into disarray, and the Lord Jesus came, made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, in order to put everything back in place. And his headship in Ephesians 1:22 is linked to this, whereby he is going to use us, the church, in this scheme to put everything back in place, and eventually is going to lift us up above the angels, and we shall judge angels. He's going to put us into an entirely new position, far beyond anything that Adam had. And so as we have borne the image of the earthy, so shall we bear the image of the heavenly, and the Lord Jesus is going to put everything back in place. And that's the emphasis there. His victory over death, that enemy, and his exaltation, all things put under his feet. And then it says, made him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. Now, if everything is put under his feet and we're his body, where are things put in relation to us? We too are seated with Christ in the heavenlies. We have been raised up and made to sit with him. And so, as one person has said, keep looking down, we're seated with Christ in the heavenlies. Right? We have this wonderful advantage point now where we are seated with the Lord, and the problems of life should not overwhelm us. We should not be undergoers. We should be overcomers in the experiences of life, because we now have this magnificent vantage point that God has given us, seated with Christ in the heavenlies. You've heard the story of the two Christians meeting on the street. One said to the other, "How are you doing?" And the other said, "Well, all right, I suppose, under the circumstances." And he said, "What are you doing under there?" We have been called to overcome, and we have this glorious advantage of sitting with Christ high above it all. In Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 15, we have this idea of the sustenance of the body, from whom the whole body receives its sustenance. Sometimes people will say, "Well, I don't go back to that church. It didn't meet my needs." You ever heard that phrase? "That church doesn't meet my needs." Well, you know, the dear folks in that church can't even meet their own needs, let alone your needs. We don't come to church to meet one another's needs. We don't have that ability. What we do is we look to Christ, the head. From the head, all the needs are supplied. He's the supplier of these needs. And as the head, he knows the needs of his people, and he is able to minister to those needs, perhaps through other members of the body, but they don't have anything to give you unless they first receive it from him. And so when we want to be a help to the people of God, we're going to have to go to him first and receive his grace and his truth and his blessing and his strength and everything that we need, and then we just pass it on. That's exactly what happens in the body. The body is the first one, right? From the head, all the blessings come, all the control, all the influence, the coordination, everything comes from the head. And so the body is blessed, and so it is in the life of the church. I'm going to leave the rest of those references with you, but I would just like to emphasize the last one in Colossians 2:19, which speaks of holding the head. Holding the head. The idea being, as Paul describes this danger, that other things get in the way between us and Christ. And he says, don't let it happen. Hold the head. Well, how do we hold the head? Well, there are four ways I've given you here in this little section. First of all, we are not going to acknowledge the headship of Christ in the life of the church if we don't personally acknowledge the lordship of Christ in our day-to-day lives. Nothing magic happens when you walk in the door of your church building. If daily we're not handing ourselves over to the Lord, then when we come together, we'll be a bunch of individuals who want our own way, and it'll just be a power struggle in the life of the local church. But if instead we're daily yielding ourselves to the Lord Jesus, then when we get together, of course it will be the most natural thing in the world to recognize the headship of Christ. When we have a situation in a local church where one particular elder is pushing his way, throwing temper tantrums, if he doesn't get his way, he's disqualified from being an elder. The Bible says, not soon angry. You can't do that. And the other elders need to stand up and say to that dear brother, listen, we're glad to have you here and we love you, brother, but you maybe have confused your will with the will of God. We don't want your will. We don't want our will either. We want the Lord's will. So let's cooperate. Let's seek to find out what his will is. And as I pointed out a little later, this is a shocking thing to some people. The elders of the local church are not a decision-making body. They are to be a discerning body. That's why the requirement for elders is not that they be smart, that they be clever, that they be good businessmen. That doesn't disqualify them. Thank God for every person who has a good head on their shoulders. But the qualifications for elders is that they be spiritual men, that they know the Lord, that they know how to discern the mind of God. Because they are not a decision-making body, they are a discerning body. They're not there to make up their minds, they're there to discover his mind, because it's his church. And we want the Lord to manifest his will to us. We hold the head. Another very important issue, a sensitive issue, and I want to be careful with it, but in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, Paul makes a big issue of the fact that people are taking names other than the name of the Lord Jesus. And this is a very common thing. It's the shame of the churches, isn't it? That we have all these distinctive names. And he tells us here, don't take names that divide. Is Christ divided? Now, we can use the term brethren with a capital B, assembly with a capital A. And what we mean by that is others are different than we are. We're a certain way, and other people are a different way. And you know, God doesn't want that. He doesn't want us to make those distinctions. We lay claim there are very few names given to the people of God in the New Testament, but every one of them belongs to every one of God's people. There's one Lord, we're all brethren. That's what the scripture says. And we need to lay claim to that truth. He points out that not only do people take names that divide, names of, shall we say, theological distinctions. It may be the form of church government we use or whatever we choose, but also names that distract us. He said, was Paul crucified for you? Not taking the names of men. Because there's only one person who deserves that right. There's only one person that died for us. And we take the name of Christ and we hold to that name. We notice that in the early chapters of Acts, how often the name comes up. They take the name. They hold to the name. And everyone who takes the name of Christ is my brother, my sister, and I lay claim to that. There's a whole appendix in the back of your notes that gives a list, I think, of 30 names given to the people of God and a little description. You might find it helpful. And then there are some who take the names of certain doctrines. He said, were you baptized in his name? And so the main point is this, that there will be all sorts of reasons why we might distinguish ourselves from other Christians. But the Lord Jesus is not ashamed to call us brethren. He's not ashamed to call every true believer one of his. And we shouldn't be ashamed to do it either. And anything that divides the people of God, the Lord says, I don't want it. Is Christ divided? No, he isn't. Now, we'll think about the ramifications of that a little bit later. But I just mention that to you because it's one way that we can hold the head. The issue of decision-making and the guidance and the direction of the Lord, committing our way to the Lord in every circumstance and saying, Lord, you show us, what do you want for this local assembly? What should we be doing? How can we fulfill your will? And so we need to earnestly pray for the elders. We need to encourage one another to hold the head. And then we have the systems of the body, like the skeletal system or the circulatory system or whatever it might be. There are certain blessings that flow between believers that have nothing to do with gift. You don't need a special gift to encourage me. You don't need a special gift to pray for the saints, right? These are things that flow in between the various saints. We enjoy the benefit of them all. The truths that we discover, we're fellow helpers to the truth. You can share something you've learned with another Christian and encourage them and strengthen them. You don't need any special gift for that. These are the systems, as it were, that flow through the whole body, and they benefit us. The worshiping, the praising, the praying, the encouraging, the fellowship, the truth of God's word, the ministry of the Spirit, these wonderful blessings that flow between brothers and sisters that encourage and strengthen and build us up. But then thirdly, we have the particular organs of the body. There are specific organs, and so there are specific gifts that are given to the church. And we're going to think more extensively about that in our next lesson, but I simply point out to you that in the body, there's not one selfish organ. Suppose my hand said, I am sick and tired of putting the food into this gaping maw. I've been doing it for 50-odd years, and I am tired of it. I'm going to keep the food. Now, what would happen? Well, the food would turn green, and I'd die. Because my hand is not designed to take it in, to keep it. It's just designed to give it away. So the hand gives the food away. The mouth speaks up and says, hand, have you had these hard feelings about me all these years? Do you think I keep it? I don't keep it. I just chew it up and send it on. I'm not designed to keep it. The stomach rumbles and says, it may look like I keep it. But no, actually, I pass it on too. And the systems of the body are designed in such a way that if the hand gives away the food, the hand gets it back in a way it can use it, right? That's how it works. Through the systems of the body, the energy, the nutrients, everything that the hand needs, that the hand gives away, it comes back again, doesn't it? And the hand gets what it needs, as long as it gives it away. The pancreas doesn't produce insulin for the pancreas, the heart doesn't pump for the heart, the lungs don't breathe for the lungs. There's not one part of the body that's designed for itself. Every part of the body gives away, and that's how you get it back. You don't get joy by keeping it. You get joy by giving it. You don't get love by keeping it. You get love by giving it. You don't get truth by keeping it. You get truth by giving it. If you're not excited about salvation, it's because you haven't given it away lately. You go give it away. That's when you get excited. I give you my light. I catch your heat. When you enjoy the truth that I give you, I'm actually the beneficiary of the warmth that comes from that truth. And when you have light and heat together, you get a fire. Now, the reason we feel kind of cold sometimes is because we keep it to ourselves. You give it away, that's when you get it. That's when you begin to enjoy it. God has designed the body that way, so there's not one part of the body that's designed for itself. Now, quite frankly, this is one of the fundamental problems with the modern tongues gift, isn't it? Because that gift, of all the gifts, seemingly, is the only one that's just for my benefit. No one else gets any benefit from it. And as far as I'm concerned, that's what disqualifies it from being a true gift of the body. Because every part of the body is designed for the benefit of the whole body. Well, you'll notice that our chapter, this section, begins not with talking about the functioning of the body, but begins by talking about the unity of the body. And why is that? Well, you know, as soon as you get moving parts, you get friction. That's why we have synovial fluid in our joints, to keep things moving, keep things from seizing up. And, you know, if you don't ever have any interaction with other Christians, well, you get along with them just fine. When you start to work together, that's when the friction builds. And God knew that. He knew what he was working with, didn't he? And so he designed it so there was lubricant. And this lubricant is described for us here in this little section. Lowliness, meekness, long-suffering, forbearance, and love. What a beautiful list of graces for the people of God. What is the big issue here? Why is it so important, this bit about unity? Well, the apostle explains it to us. At the end of the chapter, chapter 3, he says, "To him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen." That is called, a little earlier in the chapter, verse 11 of chapter 3, the purpose of the ages. This is the big idea, ladies and gentlemen. Glory for God through Christ by his people. Now, what does that mean in practical terms? Well, it means this, that God's invisible, but we're not. We're here in the world. And the world has very poor ideas of God. God's had a lot of bad press, and people don't think very highly of God. And so here we are as local representatives of God, and the way we live, the way we act with one another, is going to manifest the God we worship. And if we read the end of chapter 3, we discover that there are three main things that are revealed through the church. Number one, the manifold wisdom of God. Number two, the power of the Spirit. And number three, the love of Christ. These three have been committed to us so that in our daily experience, the way we treat each other, the way we go about our ministries, the way we live our lives before people, they are impressed with God, because through our lives comes the manifestation of his wisdom, power, and love. That's the idea. That's what glory is. The outward, the visible manifestation of inward nature, the very nature of God, that men may see your good works and glorify your Father who's in heaven. That's the idea, isn't it? So our mission in the world is to give people good thoughts about God, that they might think well of God because of the way we live in the world. That's the great mission of the church, to win friends for God by the way we live, in dependence on his wisdom and power and love. So says the apostle, if this is the grand scheme, if this is the main idea, then whatever you do, don't tamper with the unity of the Spirit. So as we read this little section, I hope you noticed it, there are two different kinds of unity. Verse 3 of chapter 4, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. And then in verse 13, till we all come in the unity of the faith. The unity of the Spirit, the unity of the faith. Now, the unity of the faith is an historic fact. It happened. By one Spirit were we all baptized into one body, symbolized in the holy anointing oil, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It's like the holy anointing oil that comes down on the head of the high priest and goes right to the hem of his garment. Oh, the fragrance. It was a perfume, you see. The fragrance of the unity of saints. It's such a beautiful thing, you know. And it happens when the various spices were put together, and we're a pretty spicy lot, aren't we? We're spicy, and the spices were put together, and you could take out a piece of cinnamon. There it is, that's cinnamon. Yeah, here's calamus. Here's various types of spices. But then the holy oil was poured in, and it became a whole. It became this beautiful perfume. The fragrance of Christ in the lives of his people. And that happens when, as individuals, we submit ourselves to the Holy Spirit of God, and he makes us one. 120 individual believers went into the upper room, one body came out. What happened? The Holy Spirit came upon them. They were baptized, immersed in the Spirit of God. And ever since that time, every person, the moment they're saved, they're added to the church, and they come into the good of that one historic event. They become a part of every other Christian in the world. One body in the Lord. And the Apostle Paul then gives us the seven characteristics of that unity. Before we get to that, let's go back and look at these lubricants. Lowliness. Let me give you two words for each of them for the sake of time. Lowliness means keep down. Keep down. Take the low place. Fight your way to the bottom. Lots of room down there. Nobody's trying to get down there. You know how it is with the Gentiles. Everybody's boss has a boss, so shall it not be among you. But whoever will be great among you, let him be a servant. And the one who's greatest of all is the servant of all. Jesus said, everybody's trying to fight to the top. Don't you realize the world is upside down because of sin? And the people who are going to the top are going to end up at the bottom. You go down and you'll find out at the end you'll be at the top. Jesus went down, and where's he? He's in the highest place. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God. He'll exalt you in due time. Listen to these devastating words. Only by pride cometh contention. Is there fussing going on among the people of God? Find the pride. It's eye trouble. Every time. Every time. Only by pride comes contention. And so to take the low place, to take the humble place, keep down. And then number two, keep back. Meekness. Meekness means I don't always have to push my agenda. I don't have to get my way. I don't have to be the big kahuna. I don't have to be in charge of things. I can keep strength in reserve. That's the idea, isn't it? I don't have to use all of the buttons I can push. I don't have to use all of the manipulation I have to force people into doing things my way. The meekness and gentleness of Christ. He says, if you want to learn it, come to my school, and I'll teach you how to be meek and lowly. He's the expert, and he can teach us. And then long-suffering means to keep on. Don't give up on things. It's one thing to suffer long, and it's another thing to suffer long and still be kind, as 1 Corinthians 13 says. But long-suffering means I don't give up on people. I told him what was wrong, and he didn't change. Oh, I see. That's how it works with you, is it? You tell you once, and that's it fixed. Oh, no. Well, then stick with him. I had a brother, an older man, who came to me when I first started preaching, and he said to me, Nicholson, you drop your voice at the end of your sentence. And I tried to take it to heart, but the next time I preached, I dropped my voice at the end of my sentence. And so he came to me and he said, you dropped your voice at the end of your sentence. And so I said, thank you. And I tried, but you know, it took a long time to fix. At my wedding reception, I gave a speech, and as we were going around handing out pieces of cake, he said to me, Nicholson, you dropped your voice at the end of your sentence. I thank God for Jamer Perry, because I go places, I never shout, but I go places, old people come to me and say, I hear everything you say. That's because if you drop your voice at the end of the, that's where all the important, and it drives people, because they don't know what you're, because that's where the important, you know what I, it drives people. So, keep your voice up, he said. And he kept on me, and I thank God for that. He said, I'll never be a good preacher, but I care enough about you, I'm going to stick with you until you learn this. That's good, isn't it? Say, well, I told him once and he didn't learn. Well, nobody learns once. Long-suffering means we hang in there with God's people. We're not perfect yet. Remember the big buttons? P, B, P, W, M, G, I, F, W, Y, whatever it was. Please be patient with me. God isn't finished with me yet. The scaffolding isn't pretty, and we're just under construction, but one of these days I'm going to be so beautiful, you won't believe it. I tell people, you don't realize how close I am to being perfect. Just a shout, a trumpet blast, and I will be. But in the meantime, you got to work with me the way I am, and I got to work with you. And we need long suffering. And then forbearance, lowliness keep down, meekness keep back, long suffering keep on. And forbearance actually means to stay under the load, to keep under, to hold up your end of the load. You ever been moving down some stairs with a heavy piece of furniture and the person at the other end says, I'm sorry I can't hold it anymore. And you think to yourself, you know, there are a lot of other places I'd rather be too right now. But somebody's got to stay under the load. There is a load associated with the work of God. And if we're going to work together, we've got to stick it out with people. We've got to hold on to our end. We've got to stay under the load. God will give us grace. If you feel it's too heavy, they say you can tell a lot about a man if when his load is heavy, he asks for a lighter load or a stronger back. If you say to the Lord, Lord, I don't want to, you said you wouldn't give me an ounce more than I can handle. It sure feels like I'm just about there. Could you give me more strength? He giveth more strength as the burdens grow greater. God help us to stay under the load. And then, of course, what's been called the Christian's overcoat, above all these things, put on love. What is love? All kinds of mushy ideas about it. Love is simply this, the selfless attention that we give to others. Our desire is for their highest good and whatever it takes to enhance their life, to encourage them, to help them to go on with God, that's what we want. It's eyes off self, eyes on others, and saying, I just want to be a little help for Jesus' sake. He's been so good to me. Well, in this next little section, we have then the beautiful sevenfold unity of the body. The universal church has no elders, no deacons, no places of meeting, no order of meeting, no doctrinal differences, no denominational titles. The universal church is all the people of God linked together. The only government of the universal church is Christ the head and the indwelling spirit. But the local assembly, well, that's something different, isn't it? So here Paul is talking about the universal church. And this means that everything in this list is true of every single believer. By whatever name they call themselves, however little they know of God and of his word, every believer has this sevenfold unity. That means that when you meet another Christian, you can enjoy these seven things together. Get it into your brain. So when you meet another Christian, you don't sit down beside them and say, hi, what's your heresy? Where are you off the track? You know, go with God's people as far as you can go. Don't immediately jump to where you're off track. We ask people, you know, for the little code word. What do you call yourself? Because that gives us a little clue as to where they're not orthodox, you see? Well, here he says, these are the seven things that link every child of God. When you meet another Christian, you can enjoy these seven things together. One body, one spirit, one hope, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. And I choose to believe that that is the historic baptism of the church. None of these other things are things that we do. I had nothing to do with making the one body or receiving the one spirit or the one hope or Lord faith. They're all God's work. And that includes the baptism, I believe. It's not one kind of Lord or one kind of faith. It's one Lord, one faith. It's not one kind of baptism. Baptism is not something that unifies the church. There are all sorts of views about baptism. But the historic baptism, you know, you find Christians and they go back and they say, the history of our church is 1826. Or the history of our church is the Reformation. Or the history, you know, you go back to the birth of the church. Ladies and gentlemen, every true Christian has the same birthday. We all go back to Pentecost. And that was the birthday of the church. And we need to lay claim to that. People talk about the old paths. I say, your problem is you're not old enough. You got to go back 2,000 years, not 200. That's when the old paths began. And we need to lay claim to that and say, there have been New Testament churches ever since that day. The Lord said, I will build my church, the gates of hell shall not prevail. And he's kept on his project all through the years. Now, the unity of the faith is different, isn't it? Till we all come to the unity of the faith. This is not a historic fact. This is a long, painful process. Coming to the faith, growing up into Christ in all things. And this is where we need the ministry of these five gifted men, five classes of men that are recorded for us. Apostles and prophets. Now, I would suggest to you, we can understand these names in a wide sense. Sometimes people say, well, the apostle, the word means a sent one. So every missionary is an apostle. And in some places, yeah, right, we're already over on the last page. I know. We're motoring through here. there is a sense in the Bible when the word apostle is used in a wider sense. When it talks about people like Barnabas or Silas or Timothy, and it uses them in that sense, men sent on a mission for God. That's the idea. But then Peter explains to us after the suicide of Judas that there needs to be someone to take his bishopric, as the prophecy said. And so, you know, they began the process of finding a man. And in order to do that, he said, well, he's going to have been a companion of the Lord Jesus, hand-picked, hand-trained by the Lord Jesus. He will have to have come under the personal tutelage of the Lord Jesus, and he will have to have been a witness to the resurrection. Those two things, along with their other spiritual qualifications, were necessary for an apostle. Now, Paul qualified. He was an apostle born out of due time, but he had private tutoring in the Arabian desert by the Lord Jesus, and he, of course, was a witness to the resurrection. And so he qualifies in a special way to be an apostle. But the only apostolic succession that Paul knew about, he said, after me shall enter in grievous wolves, not sparing the flock. He didn't know about any other apostles. Remember, Ephesians 2 tells us that the apostles and prophets are the foundation level. You don't keep building foundation stones up. You lay them once and that's it done. Likewise, the prophets. There's a sense in which we can use the word prophet meaning someone who foretells the Bible. And that's a valid way to think of it. But when Paul is talking here, he's talking about these foundational men who laid the doctrinal base for the Word of God. And you'll notice what they did. They were responsible for settling the early disputes in the church relative to Bible doctrine. They met together, they discussed these things and solved the problem. What is the role of the law for Gentiles? They dealt with those issues. They were responsible for the canonizing of the Word of God, for the selection process in which they said, this is the Word of God. And the Spirit of God directed them in providing for us the complete canon of Scripture. Once that was done, the role of the prophet was entirely changed. No longer was it necessary to have some fresh revelation of God. And so Paul says to Timothy, it was given to me to fill up Scripture. And all Scripture is profitable and able to thoroughly furnish you to every good work. We don't need any additional prophetic revelations now. The Scripture is complete. And we need nothing more. However, while we don't have apostles and prophets, we have the ministry of the apostles and prophets in the Word of God. Apostolic authority and prophetic utterance. I know as much as Timothy does about how to select an elder, right? Because we have it in the Word of God. And so the Christians can examine the portrait of an elder and they can recognize elders based on the revelation of the Word of God. We have all that the early church had. We have all the truth necessary available to us, apostolic authority in dealing with issues, in consolidating the Scripture, in establishing the base on which the church was built. But then the prophets, in the completion of the canon of Scripture, prophetic utterance, the full revelation of God given to us in His Word. That's finished. However, there are three more classes here, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. And you'll notice very carefully here in the passage that the role of the evangelist, pastor, and teacher was not to do all the work, but to equip the saints so they could do the work. Notice in verse 12 that their ministry is for the perfecting or the maturing, the completing, the growing up of the saints for the work of the ministry. The purpose of the saints maturing and developing is so that the saints might do the work. This is radical, ladies and gentlemen. The idea that our churches are not to have one minister. Everybody's to be a minister. Everyone is equipped, and everyone is to serve. And if that is true, it's no use having a few men who know it all. Their job is to equip the saints so the saints can do the work, so the whole body grows up. God doesn't want one developed, well-developed tongue and the body lying there atrophied with its muscles twitching in the sun. God wants the whole body to be vigorous. He wants every part to grow up and grow strong in Him. This is the process called the unity of the faith. Because there are things, obviously, that Christians disagree about. You've probably heard that. Maybe not in Ireland, but other places I've seen it, where they disagree. Now, Paul's attitude toward this was not, well, let's agree to disagree. His attitude was, if you're otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. There is a day coming when the church will not only be unified in the spirit, they'll actually be unified in the faith, and we won't have anything to argue about on the golden street. We won't be able to think of one thorny question to stump our brother with. We'll actually agree about it all. Won't that be quite a thing? That's a process, and it's not going to happen anytime soon. We're all in process. But that process is a good thing, isn't it? It's good to struggle with things. It's good to search the scriptures daily. It's good to test. When Paul came to town and preached, the saints went home and got out their Bibles and their concordances if they had them, and they checked up on him. And they came back and they said, well, Paul, you're still on the straight and narrow. And he said, well, thank God for that. You know, you keep at it. You keep checking me out. Because the truth is not committed to a few men. The truth has been delivered to the saints. And we are fellow helpers to the truth. We're all in this thing together. And I can't let my husband know the Bible for me, or my father, or my elders. We're all responsible. We're all stewards of the truth. And we're all supposed to know God's word. There's no special gift for understanding the Bible, you know. There's a special gift for explaining it. That's the gift of teaching. But there's no special gift for understanding it. The special gift for understanding it is the indwelling Holy Spirit, who is our teacher. And God wants every one of us to enjoy His truth. And the measure in which we do is the measure in which we grow up together into the truth. So these men, their gift was quite distinct from the gifts we have in these other passages. Now, we noticed the other night, you will search in vain in Romans 12 and 1 Corinthians 12 for the gift of the evangelist. Interesting, isn't it? Well, here's the gift of the evangelist, but his primary role is not in evangelism. His primary role is in equipping the saints so they can evangelize. Now, of course, he's going to do that by on-the-job training. He's going to be involved in gospel work. But his primary objective is to reproduce himself, to multiply the number of people who are able to effectively share the gospel with others. That's the primary role of this man. Do we see this happening today? Do we see men who don't, they're not just kamikazes who say, follow me into battle. We're all going to go do cold calling at the doors. I mean, there are some Christians, that's enough to give them a nervous breakdown. And they feel disenfranchised, like if I don't show up and do this, I'm no good as a Christian. That's wrong. God is not boring. He's provided a wide array of opportunities in evangelism. And the role of the evangelist is to pay attention to that and to see, well, here's an old lady and she slips in a tract into a greeting card and sends it out. And here's someone who works in prisons, and here's someone who has children's clubs, gets the children around. Those are all valid ways to share the gospel. not everybody's going to, I mean, some of these men who love to knock on doors, I meet them, you know, they think it's like a TV game show. Behind one of these doors, there's a prize, and I'm going to find it. And they just, you can hardly hold them in the car. They're just so excited about that. But the rest of us, it's hard going. And so these men, they understand that. And they say, you know, you might want to think about this area of evangelism. This might be good for you. Instead of forcing everybody into straitjackets and say, forward march, seeing the variety of opportunity and the variety of ministries, and to encourage the saints. And the role of the evangelist then would be to clearly explain the gospel, to explain how to answer difficult questions, to teach people how to pray for the lost, to teach people how to build bridges with unbelievers without compromising our Christian experience, to introduce them to opportunities for service. All of these things, that would be the role of this man who is the evangelist. What about the pastor? Whew, sometimes people get a bit nervous about that word. It's just a word for a shepherd. But this is different than a local shepherd. The elders are local shepherds. But this man, his ministry is wider than that. And what is his role? His role, just as the evangelist's role, is to equip the saints so they know how to share the gospel with the lost. The pastor's role is to equip the saints so they know how to care for one another. We don't come by that naturally, do we? How to admonish one another, how to encourage one another, how to pray for one another, how to visit one another, how to be hospitable to one another. That's the role of this man. You know, there are people who think you only commend evangelists. The rest of them, well, we can just do that part-time. What would a shepherd do all day? Well, there are endless opportunities to work alongside people and show them how to visit in the hospital. There are a lot of people, they just about kill the patients because they stay too long. You have to learn how to do this. What to do in a funeral home. How to give comfort to people who are in sorrow. That's the role of this man. We need people like this because we don't come by it naturally. We have more wounds from one another. I mean, we don't mean to hurt each other, but we just kind of stomp around each other, and we need to learn how to do this. And then the teacher. Again, the role of the teacher here is not emphasizing primarily what he's teaching, but emphasizing that his role is to equip the saints so they can study the Bible for themselves. So they can get truth out of God's word, and so they can find ways to share it. Not always publicly, all different ways to share truth. I was preaching in one meeting. A brother was sitting, and he was taking notes, but they were most unusual notes. They were on what looked like little 3x5 cards. He'd just write one sentence, put that one down, he'd write another one, put it down. And afterwards, I said, "Brother, what are you doing there?" Well, he said, "These are pre-printed postcards. And when I hear something good in a meeting, I'd write it on the card. And then I take this little stack home, and I think, now, Lord, who should I send this to? A widow, a missionary, a college student away at school." And he'll just write a note saying, "I was out to the meeting. Jabe Nicholson was speaking. Amazingly enough, he said something worth remembering. And this is it. I thought it might encourage you. We love you. Sign." And he'd send it off, you see? And he'd send these. He'd spread the blessing that he got in that meeting all over the world. Simple little thing, isn't it? Well, those who are teachers will think about that. They'll think about creative ways that the people of God can share the truth with one another and build one another up in the truth. That's the ministry of the teacher. So we need these brethren. We need people like this who are going to commit themselves not simply to doing the work, but equipping the saints so we can all work together in this thing. And that means that a man like that who's a teacher isn't just going to say, "Now, here's the truth for you." He's going to say, "You know, I struggled with this. I couldn't figure out how that worked with that. But then I noticed, strange as it may seem, I looked up other verses with the same word, and I noticed the same word is over here in the previous chapter, and, well, all of a sudden it fit." That's a good thing to do. When you get stuck with one verse, look for the same word in the more or less general context, and sometimes, well, it's a clue to figure out. See, he's not just simply saying, "Here it is, the finished product." He's taking the lid off, and he's showing you how he found the truth. He takes away the mysteriousness of it, and people start to say, "You know, I think I could have done that too," right? And so you encourage the people not to think, "Oh, isn't he marvelous? Wow, I'd never get that. But to say, brother, thank you for showing me how you found that. I think I'd like to study that out myself. So this is the role of these men. They have been given by Christ. Wasn't it wonderful of the Lord Jesus to give men like this? So we're not just all stumbling along trying to figure it out ourselves. There are men who know how to do these things. They don't just do them. They show us how, so that we can share the joy of a job well done, so we can minister to one another. So the role of the teacher, and this is very important, this teacher, the man in this description, his ministry is wider than one local church. And when he comes into an area, maybe he wants to take out some of the teachers, ask who are the good men in this area, men who are being a help to the Lord's people. And he maybe goes and takes them out for dinner and says, now, how's it going, brethren? What are the struggles? What are the problems here? How's the balance of teaching in the area? Are you covering all the doctrines? And as I mentioned, there's a whole page in the back here on all the doctrines of the Bible, those things that should be covered in the teaching of the Word of God. And another one on issues that rise up in doctrinal areas and how we ought to prepare for those. So he may do that. Or he may say, now, who are the good young men coming along? And he might take them out and spend a little time with them and raise the bar a bit. Say to them, have you spent any time in the Minor Prophets? No. Okay, well, what do you say we get together and we'll do a little quick survey and I'll show you what to look for in each of the books. I'm not going to tell you what's in them. But I'll tell you, if you take this road, watch out for these things. This will be a good trip. You'll enjoy this trip, right? It's an expensive way to preach because you're giving away what took you months to find out in a matter of 30 seconds. But then you're letting these people have the joy of discovery and get up and share it with others too, right? Well, let me conclude with this idea. Make straight paths for your feet, but have a heart big enough for all of God's people. The Lord wants us to be consistent with the truth that we've received from His Word. He doesn't want us to compromise truth. It was precious and it cost the death of Christ to provide it. But we can go with God's people a lot farther than we go sometimes. If I'm walking from here to Newcastle and I find somebody who's walking halfway, I don't say to them, sorry, I can't go with you. I can go with them as far as we can go, right? And I can enjoy their fellowship, build bridges. It brings joy to the heart of the Lord when He sees His people sharing Christ with each other. Ultimately, that's what we have in common, isn't it? We have Christ, and we'll share Him forever. And so may the Lord encourage us as we look at this rather distinctive passage on gifts, quite different to what we'll be looking at tomorrow evening, to once again thrill to the truth that God knew what we'd be like, that people are like people, and friction builds, and He anticipated that, and He has provided these wonderful graces, and if we're a bit short on them, we know where to get them. He has a corner on the market. If we need lowliness, or meekness, or long-suffering, or gentleness, or love, well, He has unlimited resources. The love of God shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who's given to us. And just the fact that we say, Lord, I think I'm probably a bit hard to get along with at times, and I don't want to be. I want my sweet reasonableness to be known to all men. Would you work with me in that? Would you teach me to be gracious? I want to be. You'll never regret being gracious with another person. You'll never be sorry that you were patient, that you were long-suffering or loving. Never will. You will regret that you got a bit tough with them, a bit hard on them, a bit critical of them. You will be sorry for that. It helps us, doesn't it, to remember when we speak to another Christian that we're doing it to the Lord. He's the head, and we're the body. And when we touch the body, we affect the head. He is so intimately connected to us that He says, inasmuch as you've done it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. So may the Lord encourage us to see Christ in our brother, and if we can't, to see our brother in Christ, and to seek to minister to that person in such a way that the Lord Jesus receives the glory and his people receive the benefit. And someday when we get home to glory, the Lord will say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Shall we pray? Father, oh, how we thank thee for the great mystery of the church. But we thank thee too for the things that are not very mysterious at all. They're quite plain, they're quite obvious, that we have to work together and we need to help each other and we need one another. There's not one part of the body that is a vestigial organ. We need each other. And we don't have all the gifts. We need others to minister to us in ways that we can't minister to ourselves. The heart can't breathe. The lungs can't pump the blood. They need each other. And we need one another too. Help us not to get cocky or so sure of ourselves or proud that we forget that we are just one little member, a vital member, but one member of a great body. Help us to cooperate with one another, to minister to one another, to find ways to encourage each other, and so much the more as we see the day approaching. We ask in the Savior's name. Amen.